fairly serious. As far as your order of worship is concerned, on the monitors, again as usual, also in the worship folder in its entirety, follow along there. But if you're going to use the worship folder exclusively, then you need to use the hymn book for the lyrics to the hymns. But if you're going to use the worship folder and the monitors, that usually works pretty well. We have some special intercessions before us this morning. Olga and Del, 52 years of happy marriage together. Michael McBrien is announcing and asks a prayer of thanksgiving for his engagement to Nicole Fine. Feeney? Thank you, Feeney. Congratulations for that. I've just recently been informed that Steve Bruns, you remember he was a deacon here quite a number of years ago, and recently we gave him a gift as an encouragement because of his chronic back pain and what seemed to be accelerating. Well, he's on the mend. Apparently the back pain is starting to recede. And we can thank God for that. On a more serious note, friends of Michael, Rich and Irvina Pablo, lost their son Gus, 19 years old, to a traffic accident. Died as a result of that. And then if you're wondering why there's no pre-service music, Hannah's out of town. We expected that. But Rachel Danker, who was assigned to play for us this morning, learned yesterday that her father died suddenly and unexpectedly. She didn't have all the details in hand. He and his wife were up in Lakeside, and apparently he just collapsed. She called the EMTs and the paramedics. They came as quickly as they could. They tried to revive him at the house, but they could not. Tried to get him to a hospital as quickly as possible, but basically told her, we don't think there's any hope for him to be resuscitated at all, and that's what happened. So obviously, she needed to go up to Lakeside to be with her mother. No harm, no foul there whatsoever. She kept, don't apologize, just go. And I counseled with her a little bit and prayed with her a little bit over the phone and told her to call me when she got there. She is safely there, but we will have a prayer of thanksgiving because her father died as a Christian, as a disciple of Jesus Christ. He's in heaven now. We're happy about that. But her sorrow is immeasurable at this point in time, and we will also ask God to give her the comfort she needs to get through this difficult time in her life. So, are there any other prayer requests that anybody else wants us to offer up this morning? Yes, sir. God is still good. That's one of the focuses we want you to have this morning as you work through the readings. And an encouragement that you need to really listen carefully to the scriptures, not only when they're read here in church, but you take them home, you work with them on your own so that you can actually hear what the Lord is trying to get through to you in terms of his wisdom and especially the knowledge of forgiveness in Jesus Christ. Those thoughts in mind, please take a moment for your own private preparation for worship. Our opening hymn is 226, To Your Temple I Draw Near. While your glorious praise is sung.
Touch my lips, unloose my tongue, that my joyful soul may bless Christ the Lord, my righteousness. While the prayers of saints ascend, God of love to mine attend. Hear me, for your spirit pleads. Hear, for Jesus intercedes. While I listen to your law, fill my soul with holy awe, till your gospel brings to me life and immortality. While your ministers proclaim peace and pardon in your name, through their voice by faith may I hear you speaking from the sky. From your house when I return, may my heart within me burn, and at evening let me say, I have walked with God today.
We will be doing the liturgical portions spoken, not sung. Please rise for our confession and absolution. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And also with you.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son, Jesus Christ, to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. For all that we need in life and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the steadfast assurance that nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ, have mercy.
For the well-being of your holy Christian church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful God, maker and preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. Amen. The works of the Lord are great and glorious. His name is worthy of praise. O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Almighty God, merciful Father, you crown our life with your love. You take away our sin. You comfort our spirit. You make us pure and holy in your sight. You did not spare your only Son, but gave him up for us all. O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth.
Please join me now also in the prayer for today.
We pray. Lord Jesus Christ, without your blessing, we are helpless and cannot live according to your will. Doubt and fear often hamper our trust in your almighty power. Be merciful, forgive our cynicism. Move us always to respect your ability to do anything, as well as your wisdom always to do the right thing. Maintain our trust in the promises you make by our meditation on the promises you have kept. Fill us with your energy for proclaiming your word, confident that what your promise you will provide. For you live and rule with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God through all eternity. Amen.
Please be seated for our lessons.
Samuel's conception and birth into the world was the result of a mother's prayer, Hannah's prayer. Hannah was so devoted to the Lord and so grateful for the gift that she said that the boy would serve the Lord in his temple once he had been weaned, once he had grown somewhat into his years. He had been serving in the temple for quite a while, and God had plans for Samuel, for his life as a prophet of God. Because at that point in time, there was corruption within the priesthood serving at the temple. There were no real prophecies, no real proclamations coming forth, either from faithful servants or directly from God through a faithful servant. Here we have God finally telling Samuel, here I am, here's what I want you to do, listen to me. And thank God for the wise high priest of that day who told him, after several misfires, I'm not calling you, the Lord is. From 1 Samuel 3, 1 through 10. The boy Samuel ministered before the Jehovah under Eli. In those days, the word of Jehovah was rare. There were not many visions. One night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of Jehovah where the ark of God was. Then Jehovah called Samuel. Samuel answered, here I am. And he ran to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. But Eli said, I did not call. Go back and lie down. So Samuel went and lay down. Again, Jehovah called, Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. My son, Eli said, I did not call. Go back and lie down. Now, Samuel did not yet know Jehovah. The word of Jehovah had not yet been revealed to him. Jehovah called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, here I am, you called me. Then Eli realized that Jehovah was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, go and lie down, and if he calls, you say, speak, Jehovah, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Jehovah came and stood there, calling as at the other time, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. And the Lord laid out for him his future as a prophet of the Most High God. Whenever you're in a church worship service, whenever you're reading scripture entirely on your own in your personal devotions, be very much aware of the fact that the Holy Spirit is interacting with you as you read that word. That through that word, He is trying to renew old truths in you or give you new truths to contemplate and act on. So whenever you read God's word or hear it, perhaps silently in your own heart, offer up the prayer. Speak, O Lord, your servant is listening. That in mind, hymn 283, based on this particular scripture. Speak, O Savior, I am listening as a servant to his Lord. Let me show respect and honor to your holy, precious word, that each day my whole life through I may serve and follow you. Let your word e'er be my pleasure and my heart's most precious treasure. Oh, what blessing to be near you and to listen.
Let your word still be my choice. Many hardened sinners, Lord, flee in terror at your word. But to all who feel sin's burden, you give peace and words of pardon. Lord, your words are waters living, where I quench my thirsty needs. Lord, your words are bread, life giving, on your words my spirit feeds. Lord, your words will be my light through death's cold and dreary night. Yes, they are my sword prevailing, and my cup of joy unfailing. As I pray, dear Jesus, hear me. Let your words in me take root. May your spirit e'er be near me, that I bear abundant fruit. May I daily sing your praise, from my heart glad anthems raise, till my highest praise is given in the endless joy of heaven.
Pay careful attention to Paul's encouragements here. His lesson plan for our lives, just one part of many he offered in Scripture. Colossians 3, 12 through 17. Notice first and foremost how he describes you as a believer, as a called servant of the Most High. Second, please note that one of the qualities, the characteristics of a Christian is forgiveness. And forgiveness that is not based on whether or not the person you're forgiving has earned it, but on the basis of the fact that God has already forgiven you all your sins. The idea that we withhold it from time to time because our sinful nature still controls us from time to time, and we expect people to earn it, does not speak well of us as disciples of Jesus Christ. He died once for all. Now, even in the Lord's Prayer, he makes it very clear in that one petition, if you don't forgive people from your heart, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you. Forgiveness requires patience and compassion. It requires a lot of the characteristics you're going to hear described in this section of Scripture. Please follow along carefully. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as Jehovah forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom. And as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. We can handle the Alleluia sentence. Let us sing.
Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. The Son of God. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
Gospel lesson for today, Luke 10, 38 to 42. most familiar territory again, but please, pay careful attention. Which one are you? As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her house to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet, listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me." "Martha, Martha," the Lord answered, "you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her." This is our gospel reading for today. Please, hymn 290, "One Thing's Needful." Da 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 da. Lord. One thing's needful, Lord, this treasure teach me highly to regard. All else, though it first give pleasure, is a yoke that presses hard. Beneath it the heart is still fretting and striving, no true lasting happiness ever deriving. This one thing is needful, all others are vain. I count all but loss that I Christ may obtain. Let's read the rest. Wisdom from on high. With me. How were Mary's thoughts devoted her eternal joy to find, as intent each word she noted at her Savior's feet reclined? How kindled her heart, how devout was its feeling, while hearing the lesson that Christ was revealing. All earthly concern she forgot for her Lord, and found her contentment in hearing his word. Wisdom's highest, noblest treasure, Jesus, can be found in you. Let me find in you my pleasure, make my will and actions true. Humility there and simplicity reigning, in paths of true wisdom my steps are retaining. If I learn from Jesus this knowledge divine, the blessing of heavenly wisdom is mine. The word for this morning's meditation is taken both from 1 Samuel and also from the Luke passage. A prayer before we begin. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts now be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength. You are our Redeemer. Amen. Dear friends of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the author of this hymn was a man named John Schrader. He lived in Germany about 300 years ago. 6 months after he was ordained into the holy ministry, his wife died. 3 years into his parish ministry, he died. And the truth is, based on his experience, probably prior to his own death, who knows when my end may come? Do you? Just bringing to bear the news we just heard from our brother Peter this morning, did those two police officers go to the tasks of law enforcement expecting that this is the day I'm going to die? Perhaps they might have been nervous, tense, aware of the danger surrounding not only New Orleans but the whole nation, the threats that are posed on a day-to-day basis. But did they wake up and think, Today I am going to die. Or perhaps, not casting such a morbid spin on it, do any of us ever think about the fact of Jesus Christ's death for us, what that means for us, and the reassurance of forgiveness, peace that flows from the love of God, and the wisdom of offering up a prayer every day? If this is the day, be with me, O Lord. Watch over me and keep me safe in all my ways. But I am ready to go home. People in Nice, France could relate to that idea now, perhaps better than ever before. Of the hundreds, perhaps thousands, that were gathered along that walkway that evening, as they're watching the distraction of the fireworks blowing overhead in the sky and casting just bunches of sparks and colors everywhere, were any of them thinking, I'm going to die today? Today is the day the Lord is calling me home. I doubt very much that any of them were contemplating their death. We would say that to be so focused on your death is morbid and can take the fun out of all the other things that life has to offer to you. And that may probably be very well true. But then think about this. All the distractions that do exist in this world that preclude any thoughts, not so much about, is today the day I'm going to die, but distract us from focusing on the things that are above, as Paul has encouraged us to do, and think, today may be the last day of the rest of my eternal life. I am going to heaven. I think that there are times we take that certainty too much for granted and don't focus on it. Not morbidly contemplating, am I going to die today? But as one brother of ours in this congregation told me on several occasions before he was taken home, I can't wait. It's going to be glorious. I've been wanting this for years, for decades, before that brother even knew that he was going to be struck down by a terminal illness. He focused on heaven and the inexpressible things that Paul once witnessed on his journey there, which human language is hard-pressed to describe. Put the question to Martha. What is the one thing needful? That focus on what God has said? Listening? I mean, is Martha a bad person for wanting to open up her home and invite guests, prepare a meal, make sure everything is in readiness to celebrate the visit of Jesus Christ to her house? No. That was her priority. And certainly an honorable one. Martha was a willing worker. She didn't mind getting the dinner party ready at all. And we also should always be ready and willing to serve the Lord in any way, shape, or form that we can. If each and every one of us were applying the skill sets we have, if every Christian in the world were applying the skill sets he or she has to serving the Lord, the work would be so light and so much more could be done. So we don't fault Martha for that. But then think for a moment, if it was actually possible, you know, they always ask that question, if you could sit down with any personage from history at all and have a conversation, who would it be? And if you were asked that question, or I were asked that question, would our first thought immediately flow to Jesus? Immediately, without question. I want him to come, and I want to sit down at his feet and listen. And if it didn't, then somebody said, he's on his way. The Lord is going to grant a special revelation for you and a special visitation by him to your home. And when we start going, oh no, the floors haven't been mopped for over a week. There's dust on the end tables. We haven't vacuumed yet. What would he like to eat? What kind of a meal should I prepare? Oh, I better get those magazines off the couch. And where did I put my Bible? I need to put it out where he can see it. There's no doubt. When you as an individual, whether you're a father or a mother, a son or a daughter, even an employer or employee, are busy about the tasks that come across your path in your day-to-day existence. Like Paul said, if you were asked, to whose glory are you doing all of this, you would say, everything I do to the glory of God, wouldn't you? Or would there be a more rational response, as the world might view it, that, well, I want to be paid more money, so I'm going to be a dedicated employee. I want to rise up through the structure, so I want to be a dedicated employer or supervisor. I want to show my love for my husband or my love for my wife or my love for my mom or my love for my dad. And that's why I do. That's why I work as hard as I work. That's who I am in service to. And if that's true, that's not necessarily a bad thing. But what's the first command? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then you will love your neighbor as yourself. Martha was concerned about doing something for the Lord. Perhaps she was putting the cart before the horse. Mary wanted the Lord to do something for her. And that focus was not going to be taken away from her. So what is our focus? There's that new commercial out now. I don't know the actor's name, but maybe you've seen it. He's representing a different smartphone service than he used to. He used to be the guy who would say, remember?
Can you hear me?
Are you? What?
Can you hear me now?
Can you hear me now? Remember that guy? Right? Can you hear me now? Now what's he saying? Representing another service. Are you listening to that? And perhaps we could take that commercial and familiar phrases and utilize them to think about our relationship to God in heaven. Can you hear me now? Are you listening to that? Sometimes it's very hard. There's so many other things we want to do and are doing. There's so many other things we want to plan and are planning for. So many other things we want to achieve and are in the process of achieving. One more example. The recent international fervor over Pokemon Go. I don't know how many millions of people are involved in it, but I was here on the campus on Friday, and a car pulled onto the lot and stopped. Over there, on the northwest side. And two young boys got out of the car, and both of them were holding their smartphones ahead of them like this, and walking. And I hadn't thought about the game at that point. And I thought, well, did they want to take a picture of the cross? Because they were attracted to it? And all of a sudden they stopped, did something, put their phones back in their hand, just walked back to the car and said, hey, is there anything I can do for you? Can I help? And no, Pokemon Go. Like, I should know. And it's not a bad thing. But wouldn't it have been wonderful if the woman who was driving the vehicle would have brought them there to see the cross? Children, I was driving by this church grounds the other day, and I saw this neat cross planted on the property. Let's go take a picture. And while we're driving there, I'll remind you what that cross is all about. Distraction. They are everywhere. We all have them. I will include myself in that. but the one thing needful. Have we gotten so familiar with it? Do we think we know it so well? Do we believe that we are applying it so accurately in our lives that we don't really hear the Lord calling anymore? Or are we so distracted by so many other things that we're not seeking His call through His Word? Can you hear me now? Are you listening to this? Forgiveness needs to be restored in us on a daily basis. The peace that surpasses all understanding needs to be our equipment as we walk out the door into our lives and understand that the Bible says, love your enemies, those who oppose you, those who stand against you, those who belittle you, those who are trying to keep you down. Love your enemies. Pray for them that persecute you. Are we forgetting already that the Bible says, insofar as it depends on you, be at peace with all people? How is it possible? Focus. Forgiveness. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Love. God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son. Peace. Peace I give you. My peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Wisdom. If any man would seek wisdom from God, he must pray for it and seek it, and once receiving it, act on it. Listen to the Lord, but do that by getting into the Word, because without that process, the Holy Spirit cannot renew and strengthen and keep you true to the one you have dedicated your lives to, the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you listening? And go and do. Amen. He's right. Now the peace of God which surpasses all understanding can keep your hearts and minds in Christ unto life everlasting. Amen. Please, in your worship folder, you see listed the offering for today. Now, when you sit down and start pulling out your wallet, your purse, your check, your cash, your coins, whatever it is, whatever you do it to the Lord. Please be seated. Our prayers begin with hymn 289. Following this prayer, I'll offer the prayers of intercession. And there are a number of them, so you may remain seated for our prayers. When it comes time for the Lord's Prayer, though, I will ask you to stand. First of all, our general prayer, preserve your word, O Savior. Let us pray. Preserve your word, O Savior, to us this latter day, and let your kingdom flourish. Enlarge your church, we pray. O keep our faith from failing, keep hope's bright star aglow. Let nothing turn us from you while wandering here below. Preserve your word and preaching, the truth that makes us whole, the mirror of your glory, the power that saves the soul. O may this living water, this spring of heavenly grace, sustain us while here living until we see your face. Please, your kind and devout attention to the words and now offer for us. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, you are the God of life and death. You watch over all our comings and goings. Our times are in your hands. Therefore, we thank and praise you. We rejoice with our sister Olga and our brother Dell over their 52 years together as husband and wife. We thank you first and foremost for that individual love and devotion to Jesus Christ that you created and nourished in them all those years. For that love and devotion to him, we also thank and praise you that it moved them to continue to love and be devoted to each other for more than 5 decades. We thank you for all the blessings that have attended to their marriage, their successful employment, health of body and mind, children and grandchildren. All these things come from your hands into their lives, and we are happy for them and for these blessings you have given to them. It is our prayer, dear Father in heaven, that you will continue to nourish their relationship as husband and wife, keep it growing and strong, especially as a testimony to those around them of the Christian love in their hearts for Jesus Christ that always strengthens the love they have in their hearts for one another. And for as long as your plan and purpose for each of them exists in this world, keep them healthy and strong to continue to work and worship with us here at Heritage. We likewise thank and praise you that Michael has found in Nicole a person he can love and respect for the rest of his life. We thank you that Nicole has found in Michael someone she can love and respect for the rest of her life. We praise you for the courage it takes to ask a question and answer it positively. And now we pray, dear Father in heaven, that you would continue to strengthen the bond of love between these two people. Once again, as each of them loves and is devoted to the Lord Jesus Christ, so may you continue to strengthen and nourish that love in each of them and help it to nourish and strengthen the love they have for one another. Keep them safe from all harm and danger, healthy, whole, and happy, until such time as you bring them together in formal ceremony as husband and wife. We mourn the loss of Rich and Irvina's son, Gus, to a tragic automobile accident. Though a few of us, if only one of us, is even acquainted with these people, as it has once been said, the death of any one person diminishes us all. It is our hope, our prayer, that Gus was a Christian young man. It is our hope and prayer that Rich and Irvina are also Christian people, so that the comfort that can come from your word to any witness about it can be offered to them and build them up when they are feeling so down. We ask that such witness would be prominent in their lives from this day forward, so that rather falling into deep despair, they can rise above these circumstances by leaning on the Lord Jesus Christ, who has said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." We ask you to watch over our sister, Rachel Dankert, as she now confronts the loss of her father's physical body to life in this world. It is sudden and unexpected, Father, and so you know the sorrow that has entered into her hearts and would seek to bring her down to despair. We pray that you would raise her up in Christ. Keep her mindful of what Jesus said to Martha, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." We know that her father is with you now in heaven. We know he is rejoicing with the saints that preceded him. We pray that the knowledge of such joy in his life now in heaven would suffuse her life here on earth, and that the good news about Jesus Christ and his resurrected glory would serve to comfort both her and her mother and all those who knew and loved her father. As you have given her safe travel to Lakeside to be with her mother, Grant everyone traveling to this part of the world for the memorial service safe travel as well. And may they share their sorrow. May we learn to mourn with those who mourn. But also may there be joy that we can rejoice with those who rejoice in the Lord. We are saddened to hear this morning, Father, two more police officers have been murdered in New Orleans. Tragic, murderous onslaught of such things has shaken this nation, has shaken the world. We are living, Father, in such dangerous times where people feel that their own opinions justify illegal, immoral, and such murderous action. We pray for these two law officers and their families, that their families, dear Father, please, our Christian families, that they can again find comfort in the Word of God and in the knowledge that their fathers, brothers are in heaven with Jesus. It's still going to be difficult for them and for that city. So we ask once again that the comfort that can come from proclaiming Jesus Christ to the world would be proclaimed by the Christians that are present in New Orleans. May the Holy Christian Church rise to this occasion. May it seek to teach, to instruct, to rebuke, to correct, but to do so in the peace of Jesus Christ, that peace may once again come to that city and our nation. And we pray, dear Father in heaven, that people would desist from such radical actions. That somehow or other, if it is your plan and your purpose, you would prevent such things from happening. But as you have said, we will have trouble in this world. So now we pray that if that trouble ever knocks on our door, we are prepared. We can rejoice in the certainty of our knowledge of life in heaven with you and seek to share that certainty with anyone else living in a world where danger now walks the streets of almost every city in the nation. We ask for these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Please rise for the Lord's prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. And this is what he told them. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after the supper, he took the Thanksgiving cup, the Eucharist cup, and he blessed it, and then he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood shed for you for the remission of all your sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." That being the case, peace of the Lord be with you always. So we all say, Amen. Amen. Please be seated. During the distribution, please use those two hymns posted as solid meditation on your relationship to Jesus Christ and what it means for you. Thank you. of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and for you for the remission of all your sins. Take the drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for you. May the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve each and every one of you in the true and saving faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We now depart. Have peace with the Lord. Amen. Shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Shed for you for the remission of all your sins. May the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in with and under this bread and wine, strengthen and preserve each and every one of you in the true and saving faith of the life everlasting. Amen. You now depart at peace with the Lord. Amen. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. Take and drink, this is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. May the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in with and under this bread and wine, strengthen and preserve each and every one of you in the true and saving faith unto life everlasting. Amen. You now depart. At peace with the Lord. Amen. Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. Take it from you. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. Blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all of your sins. Take a drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, shed for you. May the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve each and every one of you in the true and saving faith unto life everlasting. Amen. You now depart at peace with the Lord. Amen. Body of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for your sins. Likewise, take and drink. It is the true blood of your Lord and Savior shed for you. May the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior, in with and under this bread and wine, strengthen and preserve you in the true and saving faith into life everlasting. Amen. Dear brother, depart in peace. Please rise and join me in giving thanksgiving to the Lord. We will sing, "Thank the Lord." Thank the Lord and sing His praise. Tell everyone what He has done. Let all who seek the Lord rejoice and proudly bear His name. He renews His promise. Special intercessions, please bow your heads for that prayer. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, you call men and women into the holy ministry to serve your servants, to help them grow in the training and instruction of the Lord. And we were so blessed by Steve Bruns when he served as a deacon here so many years ago. Since that time, you know, he has been struggling with chronic and often debilitating back pain. But we are pleased to learn this morning, Father, that it is apparent that the disease that is afflicting him or the pain that has struck him down is receding. Our prayers are being answered, and we pray that by whatever medications he may be taking or just by a miracle of your own will, your own power, you would completely remove forever any pain from his back so that he can be more aptly and ably, capably and constantly serve you as he serves the members of his church and of his community and of his employment. We ask for this blessing upon him in Jesus' name. Amen. Now hear the prayer of your people, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give to you his peace. Amen. 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 Please be seated for our closing.
Of Christ our Savior and the Father's boundless love with the Holy Spirit's favor rest upon us from above. So may we abide in union with each other and the Lord, gathered here in blessed communion by the
The announcements that you need to consider are in the bulletin covered there completely. Look for meditations out on the entryway table to your left. The announcements, the refreshments after the service, and then following that, the Bible study identified at the top of page 6. This week we're going to take a look at success and whether or not that has become an idol for those of us who pursue it with all our heart, soul, minds, and strength. There's some very interesting and challenging descriptions in there by the author of this Bible study, one of which I want to see whether you are as challenged by it as I was. So please, all are welcome to stay for that Bible study. The record for this week, Jamming for Jesus Tuesday night, that's accurate, right, Pete?
Yes.
Okay, we're good for that. Wednesday, we're still on the adult Bible study, timeless topics. This week, we're looking at intelligent design, friend or foe in the war of worldviews, continuing that. Global warming. We have to finish intelligent design, but global warming is going to be on the plate for this week. And by the way, if you're coming to Wednesday morning Bible study this week, we're meeting here in the sanctuary. There's a film that we're going to be viewing, and it proves to be very interesting and entertaining about intelligent design. On the table beneath the track rack, look for those business cards. If you didn't get a laser-etched name tag and you want one, you got to sign your name to the list also under the track rack. The statistics for this coming quarter, nearly ending, are on the back page. I apologize for any faux pas that I made this morning, things that I may have missed in the order of worship. Hearing about the death of those two officers in New Orleans kind of struck a chord deep within me. And I'm not saying that their deaths are any more or less important or tragic than anyone else's. And I don't even know what their names are yet. But it just, again, is just the kind of news that if you love the Lord and you love humanity and you want all to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth, you just hope and pray that that's where those men were at when their time came. So also, you be reassured. You are ready. You are servants of the Most High God. God got you safely here. And in Christ, his plan, his purpose is he will get you safely home to heaven. You have a blessed week in the Lord. Introduce yourselves.